Section 314. This is the Florida Caniac Perspective. Let's go, Canes.
Hello, and welcome to the Florida Caniac Perspective. I am the Florida Caniac. As 2019 is now in the past, let's get ready for 2020. In this episode, we're going to recap a little bit about that 2019 timeframe and maybe go back a little bit of things back from 2010 on as we review the entire decade. And I'm also going to get to some of your questions from hashtag AskFloridaCaniac. Thank you for those that submitted your questions, and don't forget to add that hashtag if you have questions of your own. Now, before I get into this, let's take a look at the standings going forward here. As you can see here, Carolina has a wild card spot in a very, very competitive Metropolitan Division. Speaking of that Metropolitan Division, that is the weak link of this Carolina Hurricanes franchise. As you can see here, there's only 3 wins in the entire division, where they bode pretty well against the rest of the NHL. With the majority of the games remaining in the Metropolitan Division, this is where Carolina really needs to step up if they're going to continue to maintain that competitiveness within that division to gain themselves spots in the playoff run. Now, let's take a look at what was the 2019 calendar year.
Expressing themselves for joy of winning. They don't do this thing in the net. It's professional hockey. Other man, you know what I mean? I know what I'm talking about. You never do anything like that. They're still not drawn. They're a bunch of jerks as far as I'm concerned.
Let's watch. There's your storm surge. Nice. Penalized man is back and centered in front of the chance. Price can't get it. They score!
There's going to come a time I am going to score a big goal with this lacrosse move. And you won't find a bigger one than this. And by the way, just to make sure it's legal, his stick with the puck on the tip is below the bar. He is scoring.
Out of the corner. The back of the goal. Lacrosse move. He scores. He did it again. Andrei Svechnikov. His second lacrosse-style goal. Put it in the bank. With a 3-2 lead.
Here it comes, blocked in front. Blocked by Hamilton. Fed out, just wide. DeZingle's out of the box, he's got it. He'll circle, sweep check by Weber. Empty net, DeZingle scores! Ryan DeZingle hits the bullseye. On their collective feet, 4 seconds left. Mrazek says no at the horn. That's all, a 3-1 win over Montreal.
2019 was by far a very successful year for the Carolina Hurricanes, a franchise record 52 wins in the calendar year. Very impressive overall. However, beyond that, it wasn't a whole lot of success to really talk about, and I went over to you guys on the social media platforms on what your favorite moment of the entire decade was, and I narrowed this down to the top three. My number three moment overall is the 2011 All-Star Game. What an amazing feat to see an All-Star Game in the state of North Carolina for the NHL. Eric Staal was the captain of Team Staal at the time, and it was the first time it was an actual draft. The players got to pick their team type format, and it was a quite successful turnaround as well. Even though Three Doors Down was kind of the musical venue of the entire thing, which, let's admit, it wasn't the greatest venue of all time, but hey, a stage on the ice. How cool was that? Jeff Skinner was a notable all-star there, as well as Cam Ward, and it just couldn't have been a better venue overall, and the entire fan base of North Carolina really stepped up forward and really made it an incredible experience overall, and as well as the NHL. And let's not forget the fact that the whole Carolina Marvel thing kind of came into play as well with the Hurricane, as well as some other colorful Marvel characters. And as well, my favorite part of the All-Star Game, that lovely generation aspect with Ron Francis, Eric Staal, and Rod Brindamore all on the ice sharing, quite an opening act for the All-Star Game overall. Now, my number two moment overall of the 2010s decade was George Alves getting a shot in net for the Carolina Hurricanes. I was there, it was New Year's Eve 2016 against the Tampa Bay Lightning in Tampa, and I was 9 rows back from witnessing this myself. With just under 8 seconds left in the game, I believe 7.6 seconds to be exact, head coach at the time, Bill Peters, told Cam Ward to get out of the net in favor of George Alves. It was already a done deal where Carolina was going to lose to Tampa Bay 3-1 anyway, and George Alves got his 7.6 seconds of NHL ice time officially on record book. It was quite a momentous occasion, and I'm sure it's something that George himself will never forget, as well as the rest of the local Carolina community. The well-favored number one overall play of the 2010s decade, you guessed it, the Brock McGinn goal to seal the deal against the Washington Capitals in Game 7 of Round 1 of the 2019 Stanley Cup Playoffs. In double overtime, the Carolina Hurricanes came back from a 2-0 deficit to only tie the game up, and Justin Williams threw one on the net. It just happened to hit Brock McGinn's stick at the right place, right time. You got a goal against Braden Holtby, and Carolina was able to move on to the second round, beating the defending Stanley Cup champions. Oh, how sweet it was as they went on to the second round to sweep the New York Islanders. And of course, the rest was history. Overall, these were my three top overall favorites of the 2010s decade of the Carolina Hurricanes. And now to get to your questions from hashtag AskTheFloridaCaniac. If you want to submit your own questions, just go on to my social media pages, ask a question, and don't forget to add that hashtag. First question comes from Ashley Poston, and she asked pretty much simple, are Nino, Aho, and Svech performing the way they should be? Well, I would say yes, they are. As you can see from the stats here overall, especially Aho and Svechnikov are performing very, very well. Nino Niederreiter is kind of on pace to do just about the same he did even when he started with the Minnesota Wild last season going into the rest of the 18-19 season at the time. So he's kind of on pace to do that 15-20 goal mark, and he's starting to make strides as well overall. I think this is a good sign for sure, and they're all three very, very healthy going into the second half of the season for sure. Only time will tell to see where the numbers will really go from here. The next question comes from Richard Loreth, as he asks a goalie question here is, when a goalie is in the zone, how do you get them out of that comfort zone? Quite simple. It's really difficult to get a goalie completely out of the comfort zone. You got to be one heck of a chirper, or you really got to get in their head to get that out of the zone per se. In many cases, when the goalie is in the zone, it's really hard to get them out of there, especially when they're having a very, very good game overall. The goalie's focused on one thing, to stop the puck and to communicate with his teammates. Make sure he's fully aware of his surroundings, and it's very hard to get that goalie out of zone. Sometimes during warm-ups and some other things, when they're kind of not doing their normal routine, it's very easy to get them out of their zone for sure. But it all starts with that daily routine. Many cases you will see goalies kind of do the same thing over and over and over again. Warm up the same, take shots the same way, eat the same things, get on the ice the same way, even arrive to the rink the same way, and even practice the same very way. One little snippet of that can actually throw a goalie a little bit off in a way. From experience myself, it is quite difficult to get out of that funk unless you're completely in a zone. But once you're in that zone, it's very hard to get out of, no matter what happens with the rest of the ice. And the final question of the day comes from Christopher Wilt. He's actually referencing the game against the Edmonton Oilers where Connor McDavid practically messed up a penalty shot on his own. But he's really asking, what's the weirdest game I've ever seen personally when it comes to the Carolina Hurricanes? I wouldn't say that would be the weirdest one. My weirdest game that I would have to say would be the December 13th game, 2016, against the Vancouver Canucks. This was a game where in the second period, Carolina lost a 2-1 lead to only be down 5-2 going into the third period with a 6-goal third period to Vancouver's 1 to win the game 8-6. Nothing becomes worse than that. Many lead changes were going on through, and there was even some circus-like goals that were being scored, especially Justin Falk's goal from the point where it didn't even look like a regular shot, just actually went in some strange way. To me, that was the weirdest game overall. Luckily, it was a home game, and luckily, even more, it was a victory for the Carolina Hurricanes. Just so much was going on there. Different penalties, different goals scored, just a huge amount of goals scored all the way through. It was just definitely one of those nights to remember, that's for sure. Well, 2020 looks to be a good calendar year for the Carolina Hurricanes and beyond. From the ownership to the front office to the coaching staff, I think as a fan base and as all Caniacs alike, we can't thank this organization more than enough for the efforts they put. A great product on the ice for us to enjoy for sure, and for something for the rest of the NHL to take notice on as well. Don't forget, I'll be in Raleigh January 10th and 11th for the games against the Arizona Coyotes and Whalers night just after that against the Los Angeles Kings, as I like for both of those games to be one heck of a sellout crowd for sure on both of those aspects. Thank you for watching this episode of the Florida Caniac Perspective. I look forward to seeing everybody up in Raleigh, and as always, go Canes!